H2K Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.
Basically, this PWD is the parameter name, whereas this profit is the column name. Okay. So basically, we have linked this parameter to this particular column here by name. And if you remember, we also discussed this. Same line as username. It means which password that you want to get it. So here we said that whatever we are going to read as part of username, that particular line only I want to read as a password. And if you see, read with notepad. Now everyone observe. Let me say EN1. Let me say PWD1 over here. And here let me say UN2, username 2. Let me say PWD2 here. And if you remember, I said one of the best practices here, one of the recommended thing is just once you're done with your parameters, I said, you know, okay, let me say UN3. Password 23, and I said, you know, once you're done with your parameter creation, I said just enter and leave the last row as blank. Okay, and here let me save this, close this. Now see here. Okay, now let me close this. See here, if I want to I want to print the out this parameter value over here. Here the shortcut is Control L. See here, I want to print this username over here. Okay, now how can I print this particular parameter over here? I mean, sir, I want to know what is the current value of username. I want to say, I'm saying that I want to know, I know username parameter value over here. I want to print the username parameter value here. How can I do this? Just now we have discussed, before this only we have discussed. If you remember, just now I said, if you want to know anything which is Loadrunner related information, okay, if you want to know what is the, just now I said here, this one, if you want to evaluate the value of Loadrunner parameter, right, if you want to know anything like a Loadrunner related value here, you can use lr_evaluating. Now this is the parameter. Username, password, that is basically Loadrunner related parameters, right? So if you want to know about this particular information, you can use lr_evaluating here. Now everyone observe, I am using lr_string, and if you remember, I said the syntax is double quotation, flower braces, name of the parameter. Now basically this will help us to evaluate the current variable name here. Now here, if I want to print this, I have to use lr_output_message. Okay. If I execute this, what it is going to print? What here it is going to print here in the console over here? Any guesses? Here if I execute this one, what it is going to print? Can you tell me now? If I execute this, yes, that's correct, Shika. That's correct, Devon. Basically, it is going to print this UN1 over here. It is going to print this UN1 here. Okay, it is going to print UN1 here. Now see here, there is something called lr_. Let me say next over here. Now there is something called lr underscore next row, and here you need to give the parameter file name here. Why you need to give the parameter file name? Parameter file name means this particular parameter file name. Say currently the focus is on this row. Say if you want to change the focus to the another row, so you can use something called lr underscore next row here. And why you need to give this parameter file name over here? Because a single script may contain multiple parameters. Say here if I use a new, let me say here email ID here. So this may be a different parameter file here. So a script may contain multiple parameters like this. So let me say create table here. Okay, edit with notepad. Say here I will mention something like abc@def.com. Okay, so here this parameter file name is different, this parameter file name is different. So that's the reason if you want to move the next row, I mean if you want to set the focus to the next row, here you can use this, you have to use this parameter file name over here. Now observe, basically this line is going to print UN1 over here. Okay, if I execute this one, what it is going to print? Now if I execute this one, any guesses what it is going to print? Yep, that's correct, Shika and Devon, yes. Here what I'm saying here, when you say lr underscore next row of this username dot, the focus will move to the next row here. So here currently the focus is on the second row, so it is going to print the UN2 over here. Okay. This is a row level. If you want to change the focus at the row level, say sometimes probably you want to change only at the parameter level. Say here the current focus is on this second one, right? Now let me say lr underscore advance underscore param. Okay, so here I want to this one, this parameter. I want to advance this particular parameter. So in that case, you can say that here if you print this one, in this case, what will be the output? Here I'm saying we are just changing the focus for the username only. Okay, so any cases what it is going to print? It is going to print UN3 over here. Okay, here we are changing the focus for the only one parameter here. In the earlier case, we are changing the focus for the entire row here. Now, in a similar way here, see if I am executing this for this one, can you guess what is the expected output over here? For this password over here, what is the expected output over here? It is password 2 only. Here, what I am saying here, next row means it is changing the focus of a complete row here. Whereas if you closely observe here, advanced param basically it is going to change the focus for the username. However, yes, it probably will be 3 only, because you know we are saying that whatever the focus, we configure that for whatever we have for the password, which should follow the username. So username currently it is UN3, so obviously this password should be also it should follow the thought over here. So here let me say something about this. Basically here in this case, advanced param, it is going to move to the next row of this particular parameter only here. Username is a parameter and this password is a parameter. So in this case, it is going to move to the next row of this particular parameter only here. But whereas here, lr underscore next row, it basically moves to the entire row here. Let us try to execute this. I kept a breakpoint over here. Let me use F10. Now if you want to see here in the bottom section, the output is showing as UN1 here. Can you see here UN1 here? Now let me use F10. Now can you observe the expected output is UN2 over here, and here again F10. Now see here, now if you want to observe UN3 over here and password 3 here. Okay, so however, basically advanced parameter here, they are saying that only this parameter has to be moved. But however, in our parameter configuration, we said that for this password, whatever it is there for the username, just change the same thing for the password. That's the reason it is moving this password also over here. Okay, but however, this lr_next2 and this advanced param, it's very rarely used. Okay, sometimes maybe with respect to interview, a bit important. That's the reason I just mentioned here. But in reality, which in a very rare case, we use these things. Okay, so lr_next2 means which basically moves to the next row of data. And here lr_advanced param means it will move to the next row of a particular parameter only over here. Okay. So we have been trying to understand these things. Okay, fine. And here if you see here protocol related web_reg_find, which we already discussed, we have to discuss this web_reg_save param. Now the one that we have left is lr_renovus. Okay, here renovus point. Okay, now I'll be try to understand this renovus point over here. Okay, this is a bit important with respect to interview, and of course in reality also it is a bit important. Okay. That's mainly, you know, to test the realistic approach of a particular functionality here. Okay, say for example, during the end of the month, or maybe during the end of, during every week, we will get our paychecks, right? Let me consider end of the month, okay? Probably we may get a paycheck during the weeks or 2 weeks, right? So here let me consider during the end of the month. Paychecks are, I can say, no, we'll deposit our amount into deposit the amount to the banks, right? Basically this amount will be credited to our bank accounts. In simple words, probably I can say that salary will be credited to the bank accounts. Okay, and this will be very high during the end of the month. Okay, now here suddenly in the sense, here there will be a huge load on the banking applications, right? Say for example, there is an organization where 1,000 employees are there. Okay, all of the employees they are maintaining their accounts in Citibank. Okay, so suddenly 1,000 employees salaries means suddenly getting credited to Citibank means suddenly, of course, you know, probably with a simple command we can deposit. Say. Different people are getting credit. Okay, probably I think this may not be a good scenario to explain, because salary means only one person will credit into 1000 accounts, right? Let me say in other words, say salary has been credited, say 1000 people wanted to, you know, want to withdraw the amount. Just assume, say 1000 people, say out of 5000 employees, I think, you know, this may not be a good scenario that I need to, you know, okay, let me say the other example then. Say shopping website. Okay. Say there are some 5000 users are currently logged in. Say this is some festival season like, you know, Christmas. Okay. During a festival season, say Christmas, say there were around 5000 users are logged into the application. And say suddenly there are 1000 users, out of 5000 users, say an average per second, say 1000 users are getting check out the products. Now here, this is a very critical functionality, right? This checking out is a very critical functionality. Okay, paying credit card information or entering bank details and paying the amount, that's a kind of a critical transactions. Now here I want to monitor if 1000 user load is suddenly applied at this particular point. I want to see how the application is going to behave, because it is a very critical transaction. Say if this at the checkout place, say they, you know, it has been failed. In that case, you know, probably end user may not interested to buy again. End user may not again come here and, you know, may not select the products and may not go for checkouts. So here, this is one of the critical transaction. So where I want to apply 1000 users load, I want to see how this particular functionality is going to work with a huge load. Okay, so here I want to execute with 1000 users load. So in this case, what we can do here, we can keep something called a renderers point. At this particular functionality, we can keep something called a renderers point. So what basically renderers point will do, say you are executing your script, say you have prepared your virtual user script. Okay, say you have prepared your virtual user script, say you are trying to execute this virtual user script 1000 users, and if you keep in this virtual user script, if you keep something like a renderers point, what will happen? Say this user script is containing login, search item, add to cart, and say here checkout. Pay amount and the confirmation page. Okay, so here I'm saying that, you know, clicking on checkout, before clicking on checkout, what I will do here, I will use something called renderers point here. I will use this. Okay, probably I will use something called renderers point over here. Okay, now what will happen? Say these 1000 users will log into the application. When I say 1000 users will log into the application, means all these 1000 users will not suddenly log into the application. They will slowly log in. Say, for example, here in our GoToMeeting itself, say we have 15 students. All of us are logging suddenly. No, right? Say I'm initiating the meeting. After 2 seconds, one user is logging. After 4 seconds, one user is logging. So there is a kind of course, there might be some set of students might have joined suddenly, but there will be some set of students may join a bit late. So similarly, when I say 1000 users, means all these 1000 users will not log in suddenly. Okay, in our controller, we will be discussing a concept called ramp up. Probably during that concept, you will understand how these users will log into the application. Okay, so here, say 1000 users are logged in, and say login is done, search item is done, so add to cart is done. And then basically say, when I say 1000 users, all these 1000 users suddenly logged into, say for initially some 50 users may log in, and after some 10 seconds some 200 users may log in, and after some time say 150 users logged in, like there will be some gap between one set of users to the other set of users. Okay, for the first time there will be a time gap between some set of users, at least some 5 seconds, 10 seconds like that. Okay. But however, say here, the 50 users reach this particular point. Okay, so So it will not allow you to get into this checkout over here. Okay, whenever this 50,000 users reach this particular 50 users reach this particular checkout renewals point, it will not allow this 50 users to reach this checkout here. Basically, it will stop here. It will pause here. It will pause till all the users accumulates. Okay, it will pause till all the users accumulates over here at this particular point over here. So here, when it this 50 users comes in, it will not allow. Okay, basically it will wait for all these users become 1,000 users. It will wait till these 1,000 users become over here. Once it reaches 1,000 users, then it will release these 1,000 users over here. So it will check this particular checkout functionality with this renewals point over here. Okay, it means we are basically checking this checkout functionality with a huge load, and that huge load is being suddenly released whenever it reaches the maximum load over here. Okay, so in general, we will not prefer to use this. Whenever you have a critical functionality, then only we'll be try to understand, because this may affect our system. Okay, whenever it is the requirement only, generally we will go for this. So basically, renewals point means, in simple words, it will pause all the users till it reaches the maximum number of users. Whenever it reaches the maximum number of users, it will release that saddle load, and we can check this particular functionality closely by monitoring by applying saddle load over here. Okay, say it's generally when we wanted to test this application with 1,000 users, say generally 1,000 users will not log in suddenly. Some set of users will log in sometime. At 720, there will be some users will be logged in. 721, there will be some users logged in. Some 725, there will be some users will be logged in. However, whatever the user will log in at which point of time, basically will not bother. But it reaches this renewals point, basically will wait till it reaches the maximum number of users. And it will work. Of course, we can keep this renewals point. We have to keep this renewals point here in virtual user script. But however, this will really work in the controller. Why it is going to work in the controller? Because in the controller only we will be executing our script with the number of users, right? So that's the reason basically the actual functionality of renderers point will comes into the picture during the controller. Okay, here in our virtual user script, simply we can mention some renderers point, but however the actual functionality of renderers point will work along in the controller only. Okay, let us do one thing here. Let me open this script, this EB transactions after recording. Say here, say for example, I want to page down. Somewhere we have kept this, right? Where is this? But see here, everyone up there, say basically here we will be clicking on this cell. Say for example, this is the functionality here in EV application, there is a cell link. Okay, see, here we have this cell link. Say assume this is a link which will be used by so many people, and say it is a very important transaction. So what you can do here, before you click on this, before the start transaction, what you can simply do here, you can mention LR underscore renderers. Okay, you can give some name here. Let me say cell, let me say cell underscore. And okay, and however, as I said, this will not affect right away here in virtual user script. The real effect of this renewals point will be there here in the controller. Okay, we'll extend this particular topic in the controller. I will show where exactly this particular option will be shown. So if you save this particular script, and basically if you make use of this particular script here in the controller, basically this point, this renewals point will be shown in the controller. whatever the name that you have mentioned here, whatever the renderverse point that we have here, this particular renderverse point information will be shown in the controller if you are trying to make use of this particular script in the controller. Okay. So this is about renderverse point over here. We have something called integration with quality center. Actually, here in my in this machine, basically I don't have a quality center. No, I have the other machine where in which probably I think I have a loadrunner as well as quality center. I will show in that particular machine. So probably we'll discuss this particular topic maybe in the next session. We'll see. Now here we have something like QTP and loadrunner. Basically QTP and loadrunner in the sense here we can execute QTP scripts from loadrunner controller. That's it. There is no relation between QTP and loadrunner. There is no specific relation. Basically, we can make use of the loadrunner controller to execute our QTP scripts. But again, for this, we need to have loadrunner controller as well as QTP over here. Here in this machine, I have both the things. And however, as of now, just to make you understand, I will execute in this controller. We have to start with the controller. Okay. Before we start with the controller, basically we have to understand loadrunner. But however, let me complete this particular topic over here. See here what actually I am talking about this controller here. So basically we can execute a QTP script from the controller here. Let me show that how to execute a QTP script from a controller. I will show this over here. However, we'll resume back to virtual user generator. We'll complete everything in virtual user generator. Then we'll go to the controller. Okay. Let me complete this particular topic. Why? Because I'm a bit hurry over here. Maybe my QTP is going to expire today or tomorrow. It is going to be expired. So that's the reason I want to explain this right away here. I'm saying that we can execute a QTP script from the loadrunner controller. That's it. We can't do anything with QTP with the loadrunner or any other things. Even it seems loadrunner also is going to expire in 7 days over here. And please don't post any questions as of now on controller. As I said, we have to discuss on the controller. Okay, we have to complete all the concepts in virtual user generator. Okay, as of now, I'm just showing how to execute a QTP script from the loadrunner over here. Now, everyone up there, I'm clicking on this browse button. The only key lies over here is, now if you all up there, basically, if you remember, I have been saying that we can execute the virtual user script from the controller, right? See here, there is a browse button. When you click on this one, see that it is showing that vUser scripts. It means basically you can browse for the vUser scripts and then you can make use of the virtual user script from the controller here. Okay, however, we'll be discussing these things in the upcoming classes. Now see here, everyone up there, let me go to the C drive, my documents. Now everyone up there, we have something like unified functional testing. It's QTP related. Now everyone close it up there. Here I'm instead of this user script. If everyone up there, there is something like quick tests. Can you all observe this? Now here basically what we want to execute QTP scripts from the controller. Basically that is the only thing that we can do in a QTP with the loadrunner. No other things like we cannot integrate QTP with the virtual user generator. Okay, the only thing that we can do over here is we can execute the QTP script from the controller. How to execute means, here now just select the QTP test here. Now if you all agree here, basically it has to show all these things in QTP logos over here. It seems it is not showing correctly. Whenever I say here quick test over here, whenever I select this quick test over here, basically it has to show all these scripts as the QTP. Probably let me select GUI scripts. No use. Okay, fine. We'll scroll down. See here, these are the QTP scripts. Okay, everyone, these are the QTP scripts that we have discussed in for other batch. Okay, these are all the QTP scripts which we have been basically discussing for other batches. Mm. Maybe let me open this particular script parameter using this one. Now everyone is there. Let me see over here. Now everyone up there, basically here I am trying to execute a QTP script from the controller. So here I have browsed for the QTP script by selecting QTP quick test over here. Nothing. It's opening. Probably we may discuss this controller in the next weekend. In the coming weekend, we'll be discussing this controller. We'll be starting in the controller. Now see here, if I click on this play button over here, okay. Now see here, if I click on this play button, now it is basically going to open. Here we have to give the 1 minute. Now everyone up there, now it is going to open the QTP and it will try to execute a script over here. Basically, if you see here, there is 10. Now I don't want to execute with 10 users over here, I want to execute with only one user. Probably it might have opened the QTP process. Let me see if it is open. But by this time it did not open the QTP process. Now let me go to design. And as I said, don't worry here. Now we will be discussing all these things. Let me start the scenario. Now basically now it is expected to open QTP and it is expected to execute the script that we have we were trying to execute over here. It seems it directly went into this error. So you need to connect the Loadrunner. Basically, now it is expected to open QTP and it is expected to execute that parameterization script over here. Let's see. I'm not sure what to do then. Yes. applet has to open QTP. However, you know, this is how it is. Now see here, is it opening on myself? It is open. Let me close this browser. Now it is showing some, you know, fail. It is showing some fail message over here. It seems, you know, in this particular file, I think, you know, in the script that we have selected here, it seems it has some error here. Wow, for this again, we have to look into the QTP scripts over here. Probably let me select a different script here instead of this one. Let me take this Excel parameterization. And however, see here, you know, before you select this, just select the test over here, Excel parameterization. Just say OK here. Let's try to run this now. Basically, what are the scripts that I'm been selecting? Basically, these are the QTP scripts. Okay. Now, can you all agree here? Basically, it is trying to open application. I think this is going to open a deal for loans application. No. Okay. Bambino EXP. Okay. Here, you know, here we have built a QTP script over here. Everyone agree here? This is a QTP script that we have built using QTP. And here, now on the left side, there is something called cost calculator. Now it has been clicked on that cost calculator. Now it is going to select a country here. I think it is going to select a USA over here. Now it's here. Now there is something like a destination origin. Now it is going to select this destination origin. Yep, origin destination. Can you observe this? Basically, this is a QTP script. Now I'm trying to execute this QTP script from the controller over here. That is the only thing that we can do with respect to QTP and Loadrunner. I hope everyone is fine with this. Is this clear? For those people who know basics of QTP, basically this is a script that we have built using QTP over here. I'm trying to run this particular QTP script from the controller. That's it. This is the only thing that we can do with respect to QTP and Loadrunner. That's it. Okay. Is this clear? First of all, is this clear? Okay, so let it execute. So here we can execute a QTP script from Loadrunner. This we will try to understand maybe in the next session, because for this I need to open something else. And we understood Randall's point. But the only concept that we have left is correlation, which is very, very important. Okay, well, don't think. We'll stop here and we'll try to see if there are any questions. Okay, and probably we'll start correlation. We'll see.
H2K Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.